The king then, once you've given the information to the king, you give the information to your coordinator, to your pastor, to the group coordinator, the group pastor, then it's in their hand to do whatever they want with the information they have. And then it goes on, it says, the king immediately said to Rahab, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country. You know, the king, that's a responsibility. We're to protect the flock. We're to protect the people under our care. And whatever information we hear is to help us, to aid us in doing our work and protecting the people we ought to protect. And therefore, he said, they have come to spoil the land. They are going to destroy the country. And she didn't know the allegiance of Rahab. But he was doing his duty. Do your duty. Now, verse 4. And the woman took the two men and hid them, and said, thus, there came men unto me, but I wot not whence they were. Is that true or false? Is that truth or a lie? Tell me out loud. Can we do that? Should we do that? Give me a good no. Now we go to verse 5. And it came to pass about the time of the shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Whither they went, I know not. Is that true? That's not true. It's a lie. Whether they've gone, I don't know. Pursue after them quickly, for ye shall overtake them. And you know, she sounded believable. She said, I'm also for the protection of our country, of our city. They came really, I can't tell you they didn't come, they came, but they've gone. And where they have gone, I wish I could tell you. But pursue them very quickly, and you'll be able to catch them. All that, you know, there are people that tell you lies, and when they tell you lies, and they even try to propose some kind of solution to the problem you're trying to solve. And because of that, it sounds believable. And then you doubt yourself. Oh, I thought those spies were there. Yes, you are right, they're there. But now she said they have gone. No, they have not gone. It just will make you believe a lie. We're looking at verse 6, but she had brought them up to the top of the house, to the roof of the house, and hid them with the stalks of the flax which she had laid in order upon the roof, and the men pursued after them. How many kinds of works do we do on the basis of a lie? How many pursuits do we have? How much of the race do we run? Just pursuing a lie. Because she had told them a lie. And the king believed that. And when a leader believes lies, he'll give out responsibilities and tell you, go and do that, go and do that, go and do that. On the basis of the lie, he believes. And then you are running helter-skelter. You're using all your skill, all your ability, doing something that is not necessary. That's all a lie. And all the time Rahab knew that you are wasting your time, you're wasting your life, you're wasting your resources and your skill pursuing, because she had told you they have gone, pursue them. And truly, truly, you're pursuing them. What are you pursuing? On what basis? On what grounds? For what reason? Who gave you the information that made you to take a decision, and now you are pursuing something? You need to think about your life. Otherwise, life will be a life of pursuit, a pursuit that never yields any result. And there are some people that will know, at least Rahab will know, that that's not going to yield the result, because what you are pursuing and looking for is on her roof. And then she sent you to the mountain, to climb the mountain, to descend the valley, and to search here and there and try to find out. And they send you on all these errands that are based on lying. Check up your life. That's why we need the gifts of the Spirit to be able to tell that this is the way to go. Let's look at verse 7. And since the men pursued after them the way of Jordan unto the fords, Lasson, as they were, as they which pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gates. They shut the gates. But, you know, what was that good? They thought, now we're taking security measures, shut the gates. We're going to comb the whole land. So wherever they are, we'll be able to fish them out. No, you can't, because the only place where they are, you need to ask a rabbi. All right, we hear the story you have told. You can just stay aside and search the house and search the roof and search everywhere. What if they had done that? Well, God still knows how to protect those two spies. Don't worry about them. God had given the land to the people. And there's nothing that Rahab or any other person could do, or the king, that will hinder them. But because of the situation we find ourselves in leadership, and because of the situation we are in the country right now, I'm going to take, you know, still some time and talk to you on the danger of believing a lie. The danger of believing a lie. You see, that's what the king believed. It was a lie. And that's the reason why she sent all those people out. It was a lie. Because he actually believed it. The danger of believing a lie. And if you're a pastor, you believe lies. Some people tell you, you're not going to lead the church aright. If you're a king, if you're a president, you're a governor, you're a leader, you're a director. And we believe the lies the people tell us. We're not going to make it in our leadership. That's why it's important for us to understand believing a lie. Now, lie, if you check up in your thesaurus, that is, that's a book that will give you synonyms. It will give you this, number one, lying, number two, deception, number three, flattery, number four, duplicity, double dealing. You say one thing, actually this is what you mean, but this is what you say, double dealing, duplicity. And then there's also, there's crocodile tears. You thought that was kind of, you know, our local language. No, it's not a local language. It's, you know, you find dictionary, crocodile tears. And it's connected with lying. If you check out, then there's hypocrisy, then there's deception. Number one is the danger of believing a lie. I'm looking at 1 Kings chapter 13. 1 Kings chapter 13, I read from verse 18. 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 18, he said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back up into thine house, and that he may eat bread and drink water. Tell me the rest of that verse. But a lie unto him. And the prophet, great man of God, believed the lie. Look at verse 19. So he went back with him, and did eat bread in the house, and drank water. Look at verse 24. And when he was gone, a lion met him by the way, and slew him. And his carcass was cast in the way, and the ass stood by it, and the lion also stood by the carcass. He died. Why? Because he believed a lie. Number two is deception. Second Samuel chapter 15. Second Samuel chapter 15. Leaders ought to watch, and leaders ought to examine the things you hear. It appears believable. Is this one a lie? Is this one the wisdom of Rahab? Check out. In 2 Samuel chapter 15, I'm reading there from verse 7. And it came to pass after 40 years that Absalom said unto the king, I pray thee, let me go and pay my vow. That sounds religious. That looks like what David was expecting. My son has changed. My son is now going to worship God. My son now has a vow. Let me go and pay my vow, which I have vowed unto the Lord in Hebron. For thy servant, Absalom, great servant, the servant of David the king, for thy servant vowed a vow while I abode at Geshur in Syria, saying, if the Lord shall bring me again indeed to Jerusalem, then I will serve the Lord. And the king said, go in peace. And he arose and went to Hebron. But Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as ye hear the sound of the trumpet, then ye shall say, Absalom reigneth in Hebron. You see that? David believed the lie. They could have captured him. He could have get rid of this boy, a murderer, a deceiver, an injurious person, undependable, untrustworthy son, and apply the word of God against that unprofitable, unworthy son. But he did not. He believed a lie. Do you know the result? Look at verse 14. In verse 14, and David said unto all his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us flee. The person who killed Goliath is now fleeing and running away from Absalom. It started with believing a lie. Number three is flattery. You see people flatter and lie. And when the lie comes to you, it's coming from on the platter, on the plate of lying. Psalm 78. In Psalm 78, I'm reading from verse 36. Psalm 78, verse 36. Nevertheless, they did flatter with their mouth, and they lied unto him with their tongues. Flattery. They flatter with their mouth, and then they lie with their tongue. That's how the Antichrist is going to get, you know, the people of the world after the rapture, after we're gone. Look at Daniel, and you'll see that he's too flattering. He's going to get the people of the world. Looking at Daniel chapter 11. Daniel chapter 11, verse 21. In Daniel 11, verse 21, and in his estate shall he stand up, a vile person, to whom he shall not give the honor of the kingdom, but he shall come peaceably and obtain the kingdom by what? By flatteries. And will actually destroy quite a lot of people because of that flattery. Look at chapter 8 of Daniel. Chapter 8. Daniel chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 25. And through his policy also shall he cause craft to prosper, deception to prosper through the flattery. And then he goes on to say, he shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall do what? How can people destroy others by peace? That's deception. I tell you, they want to destroy, but they look peaceful, sheepish. They're like the lamb, but a lion's inside. Their wolves covered up with sheepskin. And so they look peaceful, but actually, they're planning to deceive and destroy. But peace shall they destroy many. Now, duplicity, double dealing. If you remember Jezebel, she was the wife of Ahab. Ahab wanted the vineyard of Naboth, and Naboth said, God forbid, I will not give my possession, my inheritance, to any person. And then Ahab did not know what to do. He was sad. And Jezebel said, you are king, what's the matter with you? Why are you sad? And then, he said, because I want Naboth's vineyard, it will not be given to me. And there, you know the king, just go and eat. I will give you what? Naboth's vineyard. And then she wrote a letter to the elders of the city of Naboth and said, Let's play a game over here. Duplicity, double dealing. Promote the man. Exalt the man. Celebrate the man. Let him think that we're celebrating him. But after that, bring two men and let them testify that he blasphemed God and the king. On the basis of blaspheming God and the king, stone him to death. And that's what he did. And then they reported back, we played the game. Don't you think that everybody trying to promote you, exalt you, and they hover around you? Oh, we love you. We appreciate you. We accept you. And then we're promoting you. In that promotion, what's their mind? There's duplicity. Please understand. You're living in the world, and some of those people in the world that are not born again, they're just there, and they're trying to play their games. That's why when you study a passage like this, you examine everything. Am I believing a lie? Another one, number five, is falsehood. I'm looking at Proverbs chapter 26, verse 25. Proverbs chapter 26, we're looking at verse 25. Falsehood, and it's to destroy. It says in chapter 26, verse 25, when he speaketh fear, smooth talk, when he, the deceiver, when he, the liar, when he, the one that is not born again and is just trying to, you know, place you there on the pedestal, it says, when he speaketh fear, believe him not, for there are seven, what? Abominations in his heart. That's why you want to be careful that the people of the world don't catch you when you speak a fear. Can I show you something in the Word of God? Second Samuel now, chapter 3. Chapter 19, rather. Second Samuel, chapter 19. The reason we're giving all these scriptures is so that we can learn from them the wise, real wisdom